So my name is Julian Gillmore, and I'm a professor of medicine at the UCL Centre for Amyloidosis and the National Amyloidosis Centre in the UK, and I head up the centre here. So transthyretin amyloidosis, or ATTR amyloidosis, is a progressive, debilitating, and ultimately fatal disease caused by accumulation of amyloid, which is composed of misfolded transthyretin protein in the tissues, mainly the heart and the nerves. And the condition itself is associated with a high disease burden, both for patients and also their carers. And as the disease progresses, patients with the cardiomyopathy, involvement of the heart, develop worsening heart failure and essentially become immobile. And patients with the neuropathy, the nerve disease, lose control of their bladder and bowels. They live in constant pain and eventually become confined to a wheelchair or even their bed. I mean, it's a truly awful disease. And unmet need really is the need to arrest, if you like, the progression of the disease. So in recent years, there have been some treatments known as gene silencers, which have become available, and they've certainly improved outcomes for patients with ATTR amyloidosis. But gene silencers need lifelong and repeated treatment. And while most patients on these gene silencers stabilize in terms of their disease, some actually continue to progress and die. So there is definitely an unmet need, as it were. So NTLA-2001 is a CRISPR-based gene editing therapy, which is given by intravenous infusion, whereupon it's transported, if you like, directly to the liver, where it is designed to inactivate the transthyretin gene and thereby reduce production of the transthyretin protein. There is data, as I said to you, with gene silencers to show that reducing production of the transthyretin protein and i.e. reducing the concentration of transthyretin in the bloodstream is associated with clinical benefit in this disease. So the eligibility criteria, I'll start with that. That's essentially patients with either hereditary ATTR amyloidosis and dominant polyneuropathy, involvement of the nerves, or alternatively, patients with ATTR amyloid cardiomyopathy, a predominant heart disease, if you like. And this is a first-in-human study. It's a two-part study comprising a dose escalation phase and a dose expansion phase. So I'm presenting data from the dose escalation phase in patients with cardiomyopathy. So in the cardiomyopathy phase, 12 patients were treated with NTLA-2001. Six patients had NYHA class 1-2 heart failure, administered two different doses, 0.7 milligram per kilogram and 1 milligram per kilogram. And the other six patients had NYHA class 3 heart failure, who were administered the 0.7 milligram per kilogram dose. And the outcome measures are obviously safety in this first in human study, and then the measurement of PK and PD, the latter by serial measurement of transthyretin levels as, if you like, a surrogate marker of efficacy. So the key findings are that the NTLA-2001 treatment was well tolerated in the acute phase. Most adverse events were mild and not attributable to the NTLA-2001 infusion. There was a single grade 3 infusion-related reaction, which resolved without clinical sequelae. All dose and NYHA cohorts achieved greater than 90% reduction in circulating TTR protein concentration by day 28. And that was sustained through to the latest follow-up. So, you know, very exciting results, both in terms of tolerability and in terms of TTR knockdown. We believe that the greater the TTR knockdown, the better the likely outcome in terms of effect on patients' disease. And there's good data, if you like, to back that up. Well, I think obviously the treatment itself is actually a modular platform. So it's very easy to design a single guide RNA molecule, if you like, or to synthesize a single guide RNA molecule within this platform, if you like, such that it will target any gene in the body. The challenge, obviously, is delivery of that particular drug to the target cells. But what's been established by this trial is that one can certainly target any gene that is expressed predominantly in the liver, if you like, to potentially knock out that gene. So, you know, that gives the potential to treat a pretty wide variety of genetic diseases. And, you know, other examples include, you know, hemophilia A, hemophilia B, alpha-1 antitrypsin deficiency. I mean, there's quite a significant list of potential genetic diseases that might be treatable through this technology, if you like, and this platform. The other thing to mention is that, you know, this platform also gives the possibility, and again, this is rather a future possibility, but of, you know, potentially editing multiple genes. And one can imagine a future where, you know, editing multiple genes might be beneficial, for example, in patients who have, you know, certain forms of cancer. So, you know, the potential application of this technology in medicine is relatively broad. And obviously, you know, this is early days and it's early phase data, but at the same time, I think it's very exciting for the future. So the next steps are obviously to you know, treat further patients within the dose expansion phase, both in the polyneuropathy arm, which I haven't talked about today, but also in the cardiomyopathy arm, which I, you know, which is the data that I presented today. And, you know, with longer follow-up of patients to, you know, assess long-term or longer-term safety, I should say, and, you know, also assess obviously clinical efficacy in terms of clinically meaningful outcome measures. In other words, the effect on their heart disease.